Welcome to Lair of the Alchemist, where we discuss all things heavy metal and hard rock. On today's episode, another in my series of what I call milestone moments. These are moments in a band's career where everything seems to come together. It usually features the most iconic lineup of the band, and the album often has their biggest hit or most recognized songs on it. So the band that I've picked for today is Alice Cooper and their 1973 album, Billion Dollar Babies. There we go. Turn it around the right way. The wallet. Super cool album layout here. Comes with a big Alice Cooper dollar bill. So this was the sixth album by the Alice Cooper Band. A lot of people, some people may not realize that when Alice Cooper started off, it was a band. And after seven albums, there was one more album after this as the Alice Cooper Band, Muscle of Love. After this, the band, Alice would go solo with Welcome to My Nightmare. And then from then out, it was the Alice Cooper solo band. But at this point, it is still the Alice Cooper Band. So we have Alice Cooper, of course, on vocals and harmonica. We have Glenn Buxton on guitar, Michael Bruce on rhythm guitar, Dennis Dunaway on bass, and Neil Smith on drums. Now, I have to say, this is one of my all-time favorite hard rock albums of the 70s. I love this record. I'm a big Alice Cooper fan in general, especially his 70s era stuff. And although I love the albums that came out before this, for me, this is really where it all comes together for Alice. The songs, the production, just everything. You could say the album before this, School's Out, is a milestone moment in some ways for the Alice Cooper Band because it has their biggest hit on it, School's Out. But for me, that album isn't quite as focused as Billion Dollar Babies is. And it does not, for me, have the production that Billion Dollar Babies does. And that a big part of that is because of Bob Ezrin. Now, Bob had come in on the third Alice Cooper album, Love It to Death, which had I'm 18 on it, their big hit, Alice Cooper Band's first big hit. But for me, I love Bob Ezrin. He is one of my favorite producers, and he really comes into his own for me here on Billion Dollar Babies. You hear that starting to build on School's Out, but here, man, the production on this is just great. There's all kinds of stuff going on in these songs. For those who may not know, Bob Ezrin also produced The Wall, and he produced Kiss's Destroyer. And I always find a lot of similarities between Kiss's Destroyer and this album. If you listen to Kiss Destroyer or Billion Dollar Babies, you're going to hear all this orchestration, horns and strings and percussion and clever arrangements and vocals and just all this stuff going on. And you hear it on here, and it very similar to what he would land up doing with Kiss Destroyer. Like, you think of Kiss Destroyer, song like Great Expectations or Shout It Out Loud, just Detroit Rock City. There's all this orchestrated type stuff going on, and that's all Bob Ezrin, his influence. And so Bob's influence is all over this record with all the clever stuff going on with the arrangements. I've always been a big fan of albums that you can put headphones on and you can listen and you're hearing all this stuff kind of coming in and out. Maybe there's something that just comes in for one verse or in a final chorus. I love that kind of stuff because to me it adds layers and textures to albums and gives albums a dynamic flow. So this album has that all over it. The playing from the band is great. It should be noted that there's a lot of guest musicians on this. I shouldn't say a lot, but in the guitar slot, for instance, you have Dick Wagner play some guitar parts on here. Dick Wagner, here's another Kiss connection. He would go on to play some of the guitar parts on the Destroyer album. Kiss's Destroyer, because again, Bob Ezrin produced Destroyer. And also Mark Bolan played some guitar in this. Mark Bolan from T-Rex. So, but the album sounds great. The band sounds great. Alice sounds great on the vocals. Just everything about this album is just fantastic. So let's get into the album. I always, when I think of Alice Cooper, the band, the solo artist, I always think of big theatrical productions. That's always been a big part of Alice Cooper. And this album for me sort of embodies a lot of that. Whenever I listen to this record, I can't help but picture in my head like a Broadway show or a cabaret. And Alice has always had that sort of element to his sound. You know, he always sounds like he's telling stories and that it's a theatrical show type. He does that on stage, but even with the music, you can sort of picture, for me, these visuals in my head. And Alice always reminds me, the 70s era Alice Cooper stuff so embodies the spirit of the 70s for me. These exploring things and the style of horror that Alice Cooper sort of embraces. It's this sort of 60s, early 70s style horror. Hammer horror, Dracula, that kind of thing. It isn't really necessarily gory type splatter horror, that kind of stuff. It's more this old-fashioned 70s kind of horror, which I absolutely love because I'm a huge fan of like 70s horror movies, late 60s Hammer horror and all that. So whenever I listen to Alice Cooper, the band, the solo, it so embodies the 70s for me. I just love it. So, okay, so the album opens with Hello, Hooray. And this is a perfect example of this for me. Whenever I listen to this song, I can't help but imagine like a theater somewhere, like a Broadway show theater, and the big curtain opening, and there's Alice like up there with a top hat on and maybe a cane, and he's belting this song out, introducing like, okay, here we go, hello, hooray. Another interesting point, this song wasn't written by the band. It was written by Rolf Kempf, and it was previously recorded by Judy Collins. But in some ways, it sort of makes sense for Alice to do something like this because Alice fits into that whole like vaudeville singer showman type of thing that was so like classic in the 60s and the 70s. You know, like the Rat Pack, where people sang and danced and put on shows. When you were an entertainer back then, you did all these things. And Alice, for me, is all of that. He's a singer. He's an entertainer. He's a showman. He's an actor up there. It's just great. So Hello, Hooray comes out. It just sets the tone. Great album opener. There's a great guitar melody at the beginning. Dun, 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 dun. Again, setting up this theatrical, I could picture an orchestra pit with a conductor, Alice up there on the stage and the band playing these themes. It builds into this really nice slide guitar melody and ends with really big orchestration. Again, Bob Ezrin there. It's almost like an overture to, okay, here we go. Here comes the show. Raped and Freezen is next, and it's a melodic up-tempo rocker. This one reminds me of, sounds like it could have been on maybe one of the earlier Alice Cooper albums. It sort of has that flavor. It's not, I wouldn't say it's too heavily orchestrated, but at the end of the song, it goes into that really fun mariachi band thing at the end. And that's the other great thing about Alice, man. There's a sense of humor to it. There's sort of a dark humor, if you will, humor horror, if you want to say it that way. Yes, it's sort of these sort of horror, 70s late night horror, midnight movie theater horror type stuff, but there's an element of humor to it that I just think is just absolutely great that I love. All right, next, one of my favorite songs on the record. I love all the songs on this record, but this one I absolutely adore, Elected. This is a rewrite of a song from one of the early albums, Pretty's For You, and it was called Reflected on that record, although this version bears little resemblance to that outside of the basic melody. The lyrics are different. Basically, everything is different about the song. It has this cool, there's like a little mouth harp sound in the beginning. Wow, 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 wow. You can hear it in the background. And again, I love that kind of stuff. I love putting on headphones and hearing little things in the background. I was just like, that's just so cool that somebody thought of putting that in there. So this is Alice. Man, he just sells the song. And again, I picture him on stage in like an Uncle Sam uniform or something, you know, selling this character. The lyrics in it are great. I never lie to you. I've always been cool. I want to be elected. Great. I'll get out the vote. And I told you about school, you know, making a reference to School's Out. Fantastic. And then this is Bob Ezrin again kicking in here. In the second chorus, these horns start coming into the song. And in the third verse of the song, Alex takes the verse higher. He raises the vocals, make it even more exciting. There's more orchestration. And then at the end of the song with the choruses going on, he's elected. You hear all the horns and the guitar starts doubling the horns and they're doing like this descending, the low horns like bum, 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 bum. Just, and it is just great. It's dramatic. And at the end, Alice does this, like he's sort of speaking like a politician, shouting, "We've got problems all over the world. And frankly, I don't care." It's just great. I love it. Alice sounds just great on this. Such a catchy song. The orchestration on it is fantastic. It builds so nicely. Great. Billion Dollar Babies, the title track. A song that Alice still plays in his set to this day. Great song. Starts off with that signature drum engine. Thing. Great. Cool groove to kind of the whole song. I love the bass playing on this. In fact, Dennis Dunaway, I'm a bass player myself, and Dennis Dunaway is one of my favorite 70s bass players. Highly underrated. Great bass player. Always adds these creative little parts to the thing, and this he has this great like thing that he does, like this slide down right before it kicks in, $1 billion babies, which is just, oh man, super catchy. I love when it sort of breaks down and Alice goes into the, "We go dancing nightly in the attic while the moon is rising in the sky. If I'm too rough, tell me I'm so scared your little head will come off in my hands." just great. There's another melodic guitar solo in this. Again, it seems like everything that Bob Ezrin gets involved in. Again, I think to Destroyer. Listen to this album and then listen to Destroyer and you'll hear what I mean. There's no like just stuff that just sounds like it's just throwaway. It's like everything, there's melodies to everything. Everything builds really nicely and contributes to the song. Great guitar solo in this. Unfinished Suite has this affected, there's like an electric bass with like an effect on it. I'm not exactly sure what it is, like a phaser, wah-wah pedal or something, which sounds really cool. It's got a catchy, melodic, like verse chorus thing. La, 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 la. And then it has that, it's about some guy, you know, and there's a line in the song. He goes to the dentist and he says, "My teeth are okay, but my gums have got to go." And then there's that drill sound. And man, if you're somebody that doesn't like going to the dentist, you are just going to, this is like, it's like nails on chalkboard. Even when I still listen to it, when I was like, oh, you know, zzz, dentist drill sound. It's just crazy. And then it goes into that, it just like double time part that reminds me a lot of on School's Out. When it does that Gutter Cats versus the Jets, which is sort of a quote from West Side Story. So just awesome. Another awesome song. All right, No More Mr. Nice Guy. This is a song that probably next to Billion Dollar Babies is the most popular song. Maybe this is the most popular song on the album. You'll hear this on the radio. It's been covered by different people. Popular song, great guitar riff. Great chorus, great lyrics, just a fun song. Again, another Alice, awesome lyrics, you know, the Reverend, Then he punched me in the nose, no more. I mean, you hear the song once and it just sticks in your song. Just a great song. Generation Landslide, folky, like acoustic guitar intro, almost like a country-ish, folkish thing. It's got a neat harmonica solo by Alice. And the ending goes out with this sort of percussion, jamming like percussion thing that for some reason always reminds me a little bit of something like the Rolling Stones might have done, like around the, you know, Let It Bleed or Goat's Head Soup era Rolling Stones. Sick Things is sort of a weird, campy horror thing. Again, this again brings up that whole 70s vibe of Alice and Me, the midnight movie horror, B-movie horror type vibe. It's just sort of floating there. There's not really a lot of rhythm in it. It's just sort of the drums with these little occasional hits here and there. The horns come in on the second verse holding out these notes. And then there's like sort of these crazy noises and sound effects in the middle. So Mary Ann is a cabaret style ballad. That's what it sounds. It's like got sort of like a, it sounds like they're in a cabaret somewhere, and you can picture Alice like leaning against the piano while he sings this song, and then it picks up speed and goes into sort of this like stride. You know, you can almost picture like in a country, old style country and western bar, and a guy playing one of these pianos, and it starts picking up speed, where you could just picture Alice like maybe going into some sort of dance or something right then. It's again, it adds to this whole sort of like Broadway cabaret style feel that this whole album has for me. And then it goes out, the last song on the record, just absolutely great. I Love the Dead. The lyrics in this, again, they're so weird and gory when you turn blue and all this other stuff, but Alice approaches it again with this sort of comedic value to it, the way he delivers the lines and everything. It's got a really creepy, spooky vibe in the beginning, the strings holding out these long notes. Then it goes into another sort of double time riff thing, and then it kicks into the chorus, which has, for me, whenever I hear this chorus, I think it's like a doo-wop style chorus. I love the dead, and there's that low do do do. It's fantastic. It just puts a smile on my face. There's a great then it goes into like another up-tempo thing with like a pretty kind of ripping crazy guitar solo, slows down, and then it builds back up again into the I Love the Dead, that chorus again, which is so catchy. And just, I mean, you hear it once, how can you forget it? And whenever this comes up, again, this is this whole Broadway show cabaret thing that this whole album gives me, I always just picture the curtain opening, Alice at the front, the whole all these people out there, the whole cast of the show. There's maybe the dentist with his drill. There's people dressed up like zombies, and they're all lined up doing like a kick routine or something. It's great. And then there's those little breaks in it where love the dead, I love the dead, with the heavy breathing and the like the drum fills and stuff like that. And it goes on for a while until it drops back down and it goes back into the beginning with like that was in that half spoken, like scary Alice voice back at the beginning. And then it ends with those string strikes, bo-dat, bo-dat, bo-dat. And then the album just ends. Absolutely great, top to bottom. Love this record. So much going on, so catchy. A great example of how you can make a catchy, an album that has a lot going on in it, but it's still very catchy. It's still very melodic. There's not really any, you know, proggy or jammy or, you know, super technical things necessarily going on. But the for me, what makes the record is just the layers of stuff going on, the different feels between the songs. I Love the Dead, Sick Things, No More Mr. Nice Guy, kind of just a straight up rocker, Unfinished Suite. You know, every song is kind of a little act into itself. Here I am again with this Broadway thing. You could just, different characters. It's like he's playing a different character in every song, which Alice does so well. So there you go. I love the Alice Cooper Band. I love all the 70s stuff. I loved when Alice went solo. I'm sort of setting myself up here to do another milestone moment. I figure I can do a Alice Cooper solo milestone moment because I love Alice so much. I want to do more Alice Cooper stuff. But for me, this album is just a peak. It sold really well for the band. It was, I believe, yeah, number one in the US, number one in the UK. I believe it went like multi-platinum. It's, you know, when you think of Alice Cooper in the 70s, this album, maybe along with this 18, the song 18, and you know, you think of this. So this is kind of, for me, the Alice Cooper, you know, riding up to the peak there. I do like the Muscle of Love album. I don't like it as much as this. I really love when Alice went solo, like Welcome to My Nightmares. It's just an awesome record, but we'll talk about that some other time. Okay, so there you go. Alice Cooper, Billion Dollar Babies. I love it. Let me know what you think of this album in the comments. Make sure you hit subscribe and like, and until we see you again, make sure you stay heavy, stay metal.